And this morning, I want to go into my sharing right now. And this weekend, this Sunday happens to be the last Sunday of the year. Hallelujah. Believe it or not, my friend, we have gone through 52 weeks. And in 2 days' time, we will step right into 2019. And with the help of Straits Times, thank God for Straits Times, let's recall the various key events that took place in Singapore. One of the key issues for 2018 in Singapore is that of political transition. And we know that our current government has already selected two key political office holders as future leaders of PAP. And preferably, there will be a smooth transition that will take place, and which is very vital for a small nation like Singapore. And do pray for a smooth political transition for Singapore. The other major issue that still lingers in the background is a maritime dispute between Singapore and Malaysia. And this episode itself reminds Singaporeans that we cannot keep what we cannot protect. Hallelujah. Thank God for NS. Amen. It's time like this that it reminds us that it's so important that we can only keep what we can protect. And when I was looking at the entire saga, it's an important, what I call national education lesson for our generation. And let's pray that this unnecessary episode will be resolved when the officials of the two countries meet in the next few weeks. The other major issue that gave Singapore a major feature in the world was the U.S. and North Korea summit that was held in Singapore for President Donald Trump and Mr. Kim, if you remember. And Singapore was, as a result of that summit in Singapore, Singapore itself was the most Googled countries in the world. Everybody went to Google and started checking, where is Singapore? Where on earth is Singapore? You know, and many people in the world still do not know where is Singapore. So they Googled and tried to find out where on earth is Singapore. And this is not surprising. I've met friends in the West who actually still believe that Singapore is part of either Malaya or part of China. I said, no, China is a bit too far. Malaya possible, 50 years ago. So this is a very interesting phenomenon that takes place because of this particular summit. So we see that within the last 12 months, many key events took place in our country. And these events are pivotal. Pivotal in shaping our future and the lives of many who live in this country and beyond. And similarly, there are many, many events, significant events that have taken place in your life in 2018. And many of these significant events have shaped you, and some equally pivotal to your future that has affected your family, your career, and many decisions that you are making today. And given this special weekend as being the last Sunday of the year, I would like to walk us through Psalms 105 and to bring a closure to 2018 in the presence of the Lord so that we can have the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ to trust Him, to trust the Lord as we step into 2019. And what I intend to do is to use Psalms 105 to help us remember all that God has done for us this year, and after that, to have the faith in our hearts to believe that God remembers us as we prepare ourselves to step into 2019. So the big idea for today is this. If you were to forget everything I have taught, it's fine. But you must remember this big idea. And the big idea is that God always remembers us. Always. Can someone say amen? God always remembers us. And this is a powerful truth that I want to expound on today. And let me begin by giving you a background of Psalms 105. In Psalms 105, one Bible scholar wrote that Psalms 105 is a celebrative hymn that describes the acts of Yahweh in Israel's salvation history. And this entire chapter tells of the mighty acts of God in setting up the Abrahamic covenant, in delivering Israel out of the Egyptian bondage, and eventually in leading the entire nation into the promised land. So this is a summary, the overview of this book, of this chapter, Psalms 105. And it is this particular psalm that helps Israel as a nation to remember all that God has done for them in history and will continue to do for them and be with them as a nation into the future. So with this background, let me dive into verse 5 right now. In verse 5, it says this, "Remember the wonders that God has done, His miracles, and the judgments He pronounced. You, His servants, the descendants of Abraham, His chosen ones, the children of Jacob. He is the Lord our God. He is Yahweh Adonai. He is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth." From verses 5 to 7, the psalmist exhorted the Israelites, exhorted the entire nation to this psalm, to remember the Lord their God for all that God had done for them. Why was it important, church, for the Israelites to remember what God had done for them? And the reason is very simple. It was very important for them because what God did for them in the past would help them to have the confidence, to have the faith and trust in God for the future. The remembrance of God's deliverance would allow them to see God's power, would trigger their memory to remember God's character, would enable them to see God's goodness and His faithfulness through His mighty acts. And as the Israelites recollected all that God had done for them, gratitude would arise from their hearts. And out of that gratitude from their hearts will come praise, will come worship unto the Almighty God. And as the nation remembered God's mighty judgment on the Egyptians when He delivered them out of the strongholds of Egypt, the Israelites' faith would arise. They will arise in their hearts to believe that if God could deliver them out of impossibility, then God will continue to help them face the future as they move forward as a nation. And that's why Psalms 105 is so powerful for the nation of Israel. It triggered memory. And from the memory, it triggered faith in God. And with the faith in God, they can face the future. And I believe this is what we should do today in this service. To allow God's Word to trigger memory and to allow God's Word to build faith in our hearts for the future. And to pause from the busyness of our lives in 2018 and to remember all that God has done for us in our personal lives, in our careers, in our family, and of course, among our children. How many of you can raise your hand and say that 2018 has been a very busy year for you? How many of you? Yeah, it's a busy year for many of us. And as we pause, take time in this service to pause, we need to pause to recollect, pause to remember all that our Almighty God has done for us in 2018. You see, church, the use of mobile phone, mobile technology have bombarded us with tons of information every day, with hundreds and one notifications sent to us, until sometimes we can be numb to things that are happening around us. But church, we must never allow ourselves to be numb to what God has done for us in our individual lives, in our family, in our marriage, in our careers. In the midst of information overload, we need to filter off all that is not important and allow the Holy Spirit to show us what's really important for us in 2018. And you and I know very well that many things happen in 2018 in your life. In my life, many things. For example, you get angry because you couldn't get a parking lot. You get upset because you got a summon that day. But if you sit back and take it a few steps backwards, you realize all these are actually not important. They're very minor. These are the minor things in life. There are only a few critical things in life for all of us. And in this service, allow the Holy Spirit to show you what's really, really, really important for you in 2018. And coming back to the nation of Israel, there were many things that God did for Israel. And let me highlight to you right now a few of them from verses 39 to 41 in Psalms 105. It says here in verse 39, it says that He spread out a cloud as a covering and a fire to give light at night. You must understand that as the entire nation of Israel, when they left Egypt, and as they go through the entire wilderness, you must understand that God's presence was manifested, seen on every day, daily basis, seen upon the Israel as a nation through the cloud covering by day and the pillar of fire by night. Two things happened. Two things that represented the presence of God that accompanied the entire nation. In the daytime was the cloud, the covering of the cloud by day. And the nighttime, the pillar of fire. And let me explain to you how important it is to have the covering by day and the pillar of fire by night. The cloud covering by day was meant to shield the Israelites from the hot and blazing sun when they were walking through the desert. You must understand that in the Sinai Desert, especially in summer, the temperature can range from 35 to 40 in the daytime. Blazing hot sun, without covering, without trees. It's just desert. No coverings at all. And it's really hot. And what happened is that God then sent His presence as seen through a cloud. A cloud would descend and then would cover the entire nation from the hot and blazing sun. And by nighttime, what happened is that that cloud then become a pillar of fire. And the pillar of fire would then guide and direct the entire nation at night. And this pillar of fire by night would then provide the light and the heat needed as the entire nation walked through the pitch dark and cold desert. And you must understand that in the winter time in the desert, it can drop as low as 10 degrees. In Sinai, it's cold, especially with the wind chill, with strong winds, it can be really cold in the desert. And the pillar of fire would then descend. It would descend and drive off all the poisonous snakes and all the wild things on the ground at night. They will come out because whenever the sun goes down, then there is cooler. All the wild animals and insects will come up. And this is where the pillar of fire would drive them away and make the way, pave a way for the Israelites to walk through the darkness of the desert. So you see right now the power of what God was doing. The cloud covering by day and the fire by night, they serve as directional guide for the Israelites to follow on a regular basis. Every day, every morning, when the Israelites wake up, you must understand that when they woke up every day, what happened was that the first thing they look for, beside the manna that God will provide, to look at the cloud. And if the cloud started to move, then they say, okay, guys, pack up. It's time to go. So every day, they will wake up from a tent and look at the cloud. Has the cloud moved? If the cloud did not move, they will stay still at the spot. But the moment the cloud moved, they will quickly follow the cloud as a nation. So every day, the moment the cloud moved, the people will pack and follow it. And at night, nighttime, they would stop at the place where the pillar of fire would remain stationary. The moment the pillar of fire stopped at a particular spot, the entire nation would then know, okay, guys, it's time to camp at this spot right now. So God would every day direct and lead the entire nation. The cloud of God's presence directed and guided the nation every day during the 40 years in the desert. It was a powerful GPS, I call it. Powerful GPS that never ran out of battery, not affected by weather. The presence of God was there faithfully every day, guiding the Israelites for 40 years. And church, similarly, I'm sure that many of us can testify to God's leadership in our lives and in our families as well. Many of us have experienced God leading and guiding us throughout 2018 through His Holy Spirit. And we have experienced His presence in our careers. And many of you have experienced the Holy Spirit's leadership in your business, in making decisions in your workplace, where God was there to help you when you cry out to God. Now, how many of you here, you can testify that you have experienced God's guiding hand in your career, in your business, and your family? How many of you? You can testify today. Many hands. We can testify, we can raise our hands today because we know that God was there with us. Can someone say amen? And I'm certain many of you have experienced God's guiding presence in your workplace, in your family, in your career. It is in that experience that you recognize God's hand of leadership over your life, over your family, over the things that you will touch. And from that intimate relationship and experience with God, you know that God can be trusted as you move into 2019. From those experiences that you had, you know in your heart that you can trust God as you move into the new year. Can someone say amen? Tell neighbor right now, eyeball to eyeball, tell neighbor, follow God's leading. That's right, follow God's leading. And let me continue right now with verses 40 and 41. It says in verse 40, the nation Israel asked, and God brought them quail. He fed them well with the bread of heaven. The bread of heaven, not sunshine bread, not gardenia. Bread of heaven. Okay, verse 41, he opened the rock, not a tap water, not new water. He opened the rock and water gushed out. It flowed like a river in the desert. These two verses reminded the Israelites that God had provided for them supernaturally in the desert. And church, we know very well that the desert is a place of desolation. There's no life in a desert. It's a place of desolation, a place of emptiness and barrenness. And yet, in the midst of desolation, God provided manna, the bread, the quail, the meat, and water. And God's provision, church, you must understand, from this episode of how God had fed the entire nation in the desert for 40 years, you must understand this powerful truth that God's provision is never limited by space, never limited by time, never limited by the availability of resources. Never. God's provision, church, is never limited by space, time, or the availability of resources. Can somebody say amen? When God wants to provide, He can do so supernaturally with or without resources. And Israel survived the desert journey because of God's supernatural provision. And I want you to know that God's supernatural provision was not only experienced by the Israelites a few hundred years ago. I want you to know today that many of us in Grace Assembly have also experienced God's supernatural provision as well. Recently, I met up with a brother from Grace Assembly, and he shared with me that he went through a major surgery. He didn't expect it. He contracted cancer in the fourth stage. And somehow, by an act of God, it was discovered. And he went through a major surgery. In a very short time, he was informed by his doctors he needed to go to surgery immediately. So he went through that. Of course, he didn't know how severe it was until he came out and he realized that they did a major surgery on him. And what happened was that because he was recovering after the major surgery, he was very weak and he couldn't attend to his business. He's a businessman. And he shared with me this, that while he was resting at home, his clients, his business, those people who did business with him, call him up and ask him, "Brother, where are you?" And he said, "I'm not well." He said, "I'm not well. I just went through a major operation. I can't attend to you guys. I'm sorry." And he told his clients, "Why don't you guys just contact other suppliers? I can even give you their contact number. Go and contact them. It's okay. Go and contact my competitors. It's okay." But lo and behold, to his surprise, his clients told him, "When are you coming back?" We will wait for you. And he was shocked. This brother was shocked. As he was going through his desert journey, God supernaturally provided for him. And as I look at the Bible story, what God did for Israel, and I recognize that God is doing the same thing. Are supernaturally providing for His people in this church. This brother experienced God's supernatural provision while he was going through his desert experience. I believe that God has also provided for many of you here. Our God is the Jehovah Jireh. the provider who never shortchange us. Can someone say amen? And as I speak right now, I believe that the Holy Spirit is reminding you of His provision in your life, for your family in 2018. Because God's provision is not limited to just to finances alone. God's provision can take place in many forms, such as the provision of favor, the provision of health, the provision of protection. God's provision can also come in the form of the right contact in the marketplace, the right doctor in the hospital, the right person in the right place at the right time. That is God's provision, church. Now, how many of you can raise your hands to testify that in year 2018, you've experienced God's supernatural provision in your business, in your career, in your family, in your individual life? How many of you can raise your hands to testify that? Hallelujah. We can raise our hands today because we know God has supernaturally met our needs. And as we remember, as we as a church remember God's guidance and provision in our lives, Levi's encounters with God build our faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. Let these experiences anchor us stronger in our trust, in our confidence in the Lord as we end the year and about to enter into the new year 2019. Church, would you stand with me right now all over this place? Would you please stand? Would you stand with me? Stand with me right now as we come before the presence of the Lord. And let's praise the name of our Lord Jesus Christ together and take time to recollect all that God has done for us in 2018. And we'll take time right now to pause and say, God, thank you for all that you've done for me, individually in my career, individually for me, and collectively for my family, for my children, for my marriage, for my spouse. God, thank you. So where you are right now, just lift your hands to Him all over this place right now. As we sing a song together, hide me now under your wings.
Hide me now
under your wings.
Under your wings.
Father, cover me.
Cover me.
Within your mighty hands.
Within your mighty hands. When the oceans rise and thunders roar, I will soar with you above the storm. Father, you are King over the flood. I will be
oceans rise and thunders roar. sisters sing a verse right now. Hide me now. Only sisters, you worship Him right now. Sing to Him, sisters. From your heart, let your song of praise out of gratitude come through your mouth as words, as worship unto Him. Oh, the sisters, you sing with all your heart. When the oceans rise, sister, as thunders roar. Your turn right now, brothers. My rest, my soul. All the sons of God sing to Him.
My rest, my soul.
In Christ alone.
In Christ alone.
Come on, sons of God, sing to God the Father right now.
Know
let gratitude from your heart sing to Him. We are thankful, O God, for your presence with us in 2018. God, thank you. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah, thank you. Just where you are right now, just thank the Lord. Lift your hands right now. Individually, if your spouse is with you, collectively, just raise your hands and say, God, thank you for the way that you guide us through 2018. God, thank you for your grace. Thank you for the way you have kept us, granted us strength to walk through 2018. God, thank you. God, thank you. Lord Jesus, thank you for all that you have done for us. God, thank you. Only the keyboard, sing it together. When the oceans rise, thunders roar, I will soar with you above the storm. Hear yourself singing, church. You are King. Hear your neighbor singing to Him. Let your voice arise.
I will be still, know you.
One more time. When the oceans rise,
and thunders roar,
acapella,
I will soar with you above the storm. Father, you are King over the flood.
Father, I will be still, know you. One last time, when the oceans
rise and thunder.
Everybody singing right now.
I will soar with you above the storm. Father, you are King.
Oh, Father. Father, with gratitude in our hearts for what you've done for us in 2018, God, we give you thanks and praise. Father, thank you for sustaining us through yet another year. God, thank you. It's been tough for some of us, but God, we thank you for the sustaining grace and the strength of God upon us and our family. Lord, thank you. And with gratitude in our hearts, we want to praise you, worship you, Father. We ask all this in Jesus' powerful name. And all of God's people say, amen. And all of God's people say, amen, 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 amen. Hallelujah. Amen, amen. Amen. Please be seated in the presence of the Lord. And with gratitude in our hearts for what God has done for us in 2018, let me continue in verse 8 right now. In verse 8 of Psalms 105, it says this: God remembers his covenant forever, the promise he made for 1,000 generations. Verse 8 states a powerful truth, church, concerning God's character, who God is. Our God, the God that we serve, our Lord Jesus Christ, the God who comes into our life, our God remembers his covenant and promise. Can somebody say amen? And the covenant, in verse 9, says, the covenant he made with Abraham, the oath he swore to Isaac, and he confirmed it to Jacob as a decree, to Israel as an everlasting covenant. And what is this everlasting covenant or promise that God has given to the patriarch? And it's found in verse 11. And in verse 11, he says, to you, to Israel, I will give the land of Canaan as the portion you will inherit. You see, church, God first made the covenant with Abraham. And thereafter, God confirmed it again with Isaac and Jacob. And because our God is an everlasting God, the covenant that he made with the patriarchs will remain forever. But you must understand this as well. Even though God gave and made a covenant, but you know that it took many years, hundreds of years, for the Israelites to eventually possess the promised land from the point that the covenant was made with Abraham. It took hundreds of years for the Israelites to eventually enter into the promised land. Verse 42. In verse 42, he says, for he remembered, God remembered his holy promise given to his servant Abraham, and he brought out his people with rejoicing, his chosen ones with shouts of joy. He gave them the lands of the nations, and they fell heir to what others had toiled for. Although it took time, but God remembered his promise. And God fulfilled his covenant with the patriarchs. At the appointed time, God appeared, and God delivered the Israelites as slaves out of Egypt and brought them into the promised land. Church, these verses that I've just read to you reinforce the truth that what God has promised, he will fulfill. Can someone say amen? Hallelujah. A very similar truth that I mentioned in our Christmas service. And let me unpack it further right now. Our God is the Almighty God who remembers his promises, and he fulfills his covenant with his people. Now, how many of you here, you know that today, you and I, we are God's chosen covenantal people through and in Jesus Christ. How many of you know that? Amen? And because of Jesus Christ, we are God's covenantal people. And as we see God remembering his covenant and his promises to Israel, God will also remember his covenant with us in Jesus Christ. Church, I want you to know today that God remembers his promises with you. And as God's new covenantal people today in Christ, God remembers us. He remembers his love for you, his promises to you, and his plans for you and your family. Yes, sometimes God may seem to be slow. God may appear to be slow in fulfilling His plans and promises according to our timeline. But church, I want you to know today that God is never late. God's timing in fulfilling His word and promises are always perfect. God is never late, church. And as we have taken time to remember all that God did for us just a while ago, let our faith in Christ arise again, where we carry the confidence that God always remembers us because we are His people. And as we step into 2019, church, God remembers us and will be there with us in every endeavor that we undertake. Today, in this service, what are the areas in your life that you need God to remember you for? What are the areas you say, God, I need you to remember me in this area of my life? It could be in your career. It could be certain projects you're undertaking. It could be a decision-making process that you're going through right now. I don't know, but you know, God knows. But there's a very interesting thing that happened in the book of Nehemiah. In the book of Nehemiah, we saw Nehemiah's successful campaign in rebuilding the wall of Jerusalem. But do you know that one of Nehemiah's constant prayers was for God to remember him? Even though God commissioned him, yet Nehemiah would come before God and say, God, remember me. God, remember. You could see in his prayer. Let me show his prayer right now. In Nehemiah chapter 5, verse 19, Nehemiah prayed. He said, remember me with favor, my God, for all I have done for these people. Look at next verse right now, Nehemiah 13, 14. Remember me for this, my God, and do not blot out what I have so faithfully done for the house of my God and His services. Nehemiah 13, 31. Nehemiah prayed, remember me with favor, my God. Remember me, O God. I invite the musicians to come back again. Nehemiah prayed for God to remember him because he knew. Nehemiah knew that without God's favor, he would not succeed in fulfilling God's plan for the nation of Israel, God's plan through his life. Nehemiah knew that without God, his effort and plans would come to nothing at all. And Nehemiah needed God to remember him with favor so that he could do what his human strength could not achieve, church. And similarly, church, as we step into 2019, we need God to remember us with favor. We need God to remember us with favor in our career, in our marriage, in raising our children, in discipling our family to fear the Lord our God. And some of us, we know that the year 2019 will be one that's full of challenges and uncertainty. And because of that, in our heart, some of our hearts may even be heavy. Heavy because we know what's ahead of us. And that's why it's so important we come before the Lord and say, God, remember me with favor. And some of us need God to remember you with favor because your children may be going through a major exam in 2019. And some of us need God to remember you with favor because your career advancement comes with great responsibility, with heavy expectation, and you know in your heart that next year will be a year with heavy responsibility, and you need God to remember you with favor. And some of us here, we need God to remember us, to remember you, because you cannot achieve what you plan to do without God's